Hello everyone, my name is P. Shyam Sundar, Assistant Professor, Department of ECE, and I am Course Coordinator of Analog Electronic Circuit Design course. Today I would like to brief you about Analog Electronic Circuit Design. Most of the students feel this as very difficult subject, etc., etc. Maybe from their students they might have heard that. So today I want to clear so many doubts regarding this and make it very easy for a student to understand based on it. The simple concepts, right? Let us take as an example the audio system. If I am going to speak here and I have to reach a few students which are located at some other point, what I have to do? So if they are sitting in the class in front of me, I can simply speak directly so that they can hear with their receivers. Now if they are somewhere at a distant place from here, I have to use something like a mic. So here I am using a mic. A mic is there. Whatever I speak, that will be received by this mic, and this signal will be amplified and transmitted. It will be transmitted to some distant point, and this entire thing can be explained by a simple block diagram which I have shown here. A sensor, typically a condenser mic which is used here, this is a sensor now. So a sensor which senses the signal, I am generalizing it, a sensor which senses the signal, it sends the signal which is audio signal or message signal. It is to be modulated. To modulate that signal, I need some oscillator, a local oscillator which provides the carrier signal, and then the modulated signal will be amplified, filtered and transmitted. This is what is happening. And now if I concise everything into a simple block diagram, I can have a simple block diagram of three blocks. Those three blocks are sensor, system and actuator. So whatever electronic system you take, it falls under this block diagram. Any electronic system you can represent using these three building blocks. These are the three basic building blocks of any electronic system. A sensor to sense the signal, because the world is analog in nature. Whatever world gives you or world takes from you will be analog in nature. You have to sense that analog signal. You have to modify or transform that particular signal into the desired form and give it as output in the desired form. So, sensor senses the signal. The system, we have to design it to make the whatever signal it sends, to make that particular signal to display in the desired format through an actuator. This is the simplest form of any electronic system, right? Now, in analog electronic system design, we are going to design this system. This block is to be designed by us. Whatever signal is sensed and sent to the system, this comes under signal processing. Signal extraction and transmission, it comes under signal processing, and whatever system gives as output in the desired form to actuator to display it or to say into a speaker like that, that is also a form of signal processing. So you have to design this particular system to take a signal which we are having into the form of a signal which you need to deliver. So the world is analog in nature, as I have said. It senses the signal in analog form and it gives the output also in analog form. And this system design part is analog electronic system design. Now, for understanding this course in a more easier way, what are the things required by a student? First and foremost thing is the very good understanding of network analysis or electronic circuits. And this network analysis or electric circuit design, this is a prerequisite. The student must be able to apply whatever he learned in this particular subject so that he can analyze the systems which he is going to design in AECD. What are the things required from network analysis? The very first thing you are going to study here is Ohm's law. And maybe this Ohm's law you might have studied in your 7th or 8th class itself in your physics. Then Kirchhoff's current law, Kirchhoff's voltage law, KCL and KVL in short. And KCL and KVL also are studied in some 8th or 9th standards as far as I remember. Then comes nodal analysis. And mesh analysis. These are the five basic things which a student must know. Along with that, you will be studying network theorems there. Network theorems. A set of these things will ease your understanding of analog electronic circuit design. So how to apply these things and where to apply these things, that is very, very important. Once you know how to apply and where to apply, this AECD subject will be on your fingertips. Whatever circuit you take, you have to draw an equivalent circuit for that to analyze. So to draw an equivalent circuit, we need the basic concept of these things. So that's what we are going to do. Once a student understands this part, he is good at this, he needs to just use this in AECD to analyze, apply, design. That's all. It's so simple. Now, as these are prerequisites, based on these prerequisites, the AECD course is designed into four COs. The first CO comprises of diodes. What is a diode? How many kinds of diodes are there? What are the various applications of these PN junction diodes? All these things you are going to study here in diodes. This is the basic component of your electronics. From diodes, slowly we switch on to transistors, and I will give you a continuity from diodes to transistors. The next part becomes transistors. So CO2 is transistors, in which you study bipolar junction transistors and field effect transistors. And in field effect transistors, you will be studying junction field effect transistors as well as MOSFETs, metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistors. So these are the things you are going to study in CO2. The next one is op amps, operational amplifiers. And the final CO is oscillators, CO4, oscillators and 555 timer. And there, applications, various applications of 555 timers and their applications. Oscillators, you are having four different oscillators: RC phase shift oscillator, Wien bridge oscillator, Hartley and Kolpitz oscillator. These are the four basic oscillators you will be studying. Apart from this, 555 timer, how is it, what are its applications? Basic applications are a stable and monostable multivibrator. These are the things we are going to study in CO4. So this is the brief outline of the entire syllabus. Now, as you remember that I have told you that we are supposed to design a system. design a system. And to design this system, what are we given? We are given with some signal which is sensed by a sensor. Now let us see. A sensor is there, like this condenser mic. A sensor senses a signal which is very small. Whatever sensor senses, that signal will be very, very, very small or minute, say in terms of some microvolts or millivolts. That microvolts or millivolts signal is not at all sufficient to process or transmit. So what we do? We have to take that signal, we have to amplify the signal and then send the signal. Receive the signal, amplify the signal and then you can transmit. Because microvolt or millivolt signal is not sufficient to transmit. Now, one more factor which affects here is noise. Noise is a random disturbance signal, or in simple words we can say it is an unwanted guest which comes and sits upon your signal which has been sensed. So it is very, very, very important for us to amplify this. So whatever system you design, the very first part you design in the system will be an amplifier which amplifies this microvolt or millivolt signal into some volts, right? So you have to use this particular amplifier in the system. Amplifier is the heart of any electronic system. Now that amplifier can be designed by using either transistors or op amps. Whatever you use, either you use BJT or you use FET or you use op amp, that amplifier can be designed by using any of these. So to understand these transistors, what are transistors? They are having three terminals, PNP type, NPN type, all these things are there. Instead of that, let us see. Transistors are semiconductor devices which are having three terminals. What are those terminals? Emitter, base, collector. And the fabrication process, let's leave it. Let's don't bother about the fabrication now. So of these terminals, basically, once you come across semiconductor devices, those semiconductor devices are P-type and N-type semiconductors. The P-type and N-type semiconductors are brought together. It shows a diode action. So basically, we start with the diodes. Basically, we start with diodes. We study diodes. So to study diodes, what is the prerequisite? The prerequisite will be a good understanding of electronic configuration and atomic model and how you, what are the materials, what types of materials, conductors, insulators, semiconductors, and in semiconductors classifying it as intrinsic and extrinsic semiconductor materials. Intrinsic semiconductor materials are pure form of semiconductors and extrinsic semiconductor materials are doped materials. You add some impurity into an intrinsic material, it becomes extrinsic. That impurity may be of either third group or fifth group. If third group impurity is added, it becomes P-type semiconductor, and if fifth group element is added, it becomes N-type semiconductor. Like that, you get P-type and N-type semiconductor materials. Once these two are brought together, what happens? So there is a very you can find good videos in YouTube which animates all these things, and let's don't bother about all those things because we cannot discuss all the things now. Let us start with diodes. Main major application of diodes, then transistors. We'll have a continuity between diodes and transistors. We'll see what is a BJT and what is a FET. Then we'll continue with the concept of feedback. We will introduce the concept of feedback here, and that concept of feedback will connect us to op amps here, and we will study what operational amplifier is, what are its characteristics and various applications, and from there the same feedback extension. In feedback you have negative and positive feedback. Negative feedbacks are introduced here and continued. Positive feedback is introduced here in the form of oscillators, and then we will go to triple fighter. That will close the entire syllabus. So here, let us come to CO1 diodes. Diode, di means 2, ode means terminal. Diode means two terminal. It is a two terminal device. That's what it states. A PN junction diode, a P type semiconductor material and N type semiconductor material are fused together. Then a depletion layer is formed in between. We call this as a depletion layer with unbound charges. There are majority and minority charge carriers here because these are doped semiconductors. In p-type, majority carriers are holes and minority carriers are electrons, and in n-type, majority carriers are electrons and minority carriers are holes. I am representing holes with a circle and a small circle and electrons with a small negative sign, right? So majority carriers are holes and minority carriers are electrons in p-type. Minority carriers are holes and majority carriers are electrons in n-type semiconductor material. When these two are brought together, naturally there exists a force of attraction between opposite charging particles here in between holes and electrons, because of which they recombine together and form unbound charges in between. And this we call it as space charge region or depletion region. Space charge region or depletion region. And now, if these holes and electrons are to be recombined, they have to exert more force to cross over this depletion region. We also call this as potential barrier. So this potential barrier is to be crossed and these can recombine. So whatever energy is there, that is not sufficient. Now we have to apply some external force so that these holes can move towards the n-type region or the electrons into the p-type region. For that purpose, we are going to apply some external force, and that external force we call it as biasing. There are two biasing methods. One is forward bias, other one is reverse bias. Forward bias, you want to bias it in the forward direction. That means whatever majority carriers are there, these majority carriers are to be pushed into the N region. When it can be pushed, these are positive charges, assumed positive charges. So when a positive charge is at this terminal or at this edge, there will be a force of repulsion between these two positives. Therefore, these positive charged holes tend to move towards the n-type region or n-type semiconductor material. Similarly, a negative terminal is connected here. This, because of the connected negative terminal, there will be a force of repulsion between a negative charge and this negative charge, because of which these electrons tend to move into the p region. This is how charge transfer takes place. Electrons move in this direction. Electrons move. This is the electron current direction. This is the direction in which electrons move. So current is constituted by the movement of charge, movement of electrons. So as electrons move in this direction, we say current is in this direction. This current is electron current. But usually, as charge on an electron is negative, in each and every equation or derivation a negative charge is to be considered. To avoid this, we are assuming an imaginary term called a hole, which is of equal charge of an electron and opposite charge. Equal in magnitude but opposite in charge. So this is a positive charge, and this positive charged hole will move in the opposite direction of electron, and we call the current constituted by this hole is as conventional current direction. The hole current direction is considered to be conventional current direction. We are taking it as a convention to represent the current. So wherever we represent current in electronics, that current is because of holes. Even you take a loop equation or you take the current directions anywhere in any circuit, that direction is represented by hole current direction. It is a conventional current direction. So do remember, because to avoid so many complexities, we go for representing the current in terms of poles. Therefore, we take this as conventional current direction. Now, when you forward bias this PN junction diode, this is a symbol of a PN junction diode. When I forward bias it, that means positive is connected to anode, P-type, negative is connected to cathode or N-type. Then, whatever I have explained just now, the holes tend to move into the N region and electrons tend to move towards the P region, which indicates that more charges are moving, therefore current is more. So initially, until or unless the volt, as you increase the voltage, until or unless the voltage is greater than the voltage between these two, the potential barrier. Once the voltage is greater than the potential barrier, then the holes can move to the other side. So until then, the holes cannot move to the other side. Therefore, the current will be zero or nearly zero. Very negligible amount of current will be there. Once the voltage is greater than the potential barrier, then these holes tend to move to the other side. And hence, there will be more number of holes moving to the other side, and current will drastically increase. This increase is exponential in nature and is given by ID is equal to IS into e power NVT VD by NVT minus 1, where ID is the diode current through the diode, IS is the saturation current, E is exponential e to the power of VD, voltage across the diode, divided by NVT. VT is volt equivalent temperature. VT usually taken as 26 millivolts at room temperature. A room temperature of 27 degrees centigrade. We consider this as 26 millivolts. VT is equal to KT by Q, where K is Boltzmann constant, T is absolute temperature, Q is charge on an electron. When you substitute these constant terms here, T is absolute temperature, which is 300 Kelvin, because 27 degrees centigrade is usually considered as room temperature in our Indian atmosphere. 27 plus 273 is 300, so absolute temperature is 300. Boltzmann constant, 1.38 into something. And here, charge in an electron, 1.6 into 10 to the power of minus 19 coulombs. So by simplifying this equation, you will be getting 26 millivolts as VT. Now coming to the factor N, usually in different textbooks, N is referred to as various parameters. Usually they consider N is equal to 1 for germanium, N is equal to 2 for silicon. In some textbooks, it will be taken as N is equal to 1 for germanium and N is equal to 2 for silicon. But usually when you go for the David Bell explanation in David Bell, he mentions for fabrication part, N is equal to 2 will be taken, and when the diode is taken as a hardware component, N is equal to 1 is considered. So whatever notation you feel free, you can consider. Usually this N, we'll just substitute N is equal to 1 in general. We'll just substitute N is equal to 1 in general until or unless it is specified. Okay, this is the diode current equation, which is very, very important. Let's don't go for other details. These are the forward biased characteristics. Once the potential voltage is increased beyond potential barrier, then the current increases drastically in an exponential manner. For a small variation in voltage, there will be a large variation in current. So if you want to calculate resistance at any point, say at this point, drop a perpendicular onto the x-axis and drop a perpendicular onto the y-axis. This is voltage at a particular instance, this is current at that particular instance. Voltage by current will give you the resistance. We call that as instantaneous voltage by instantaneous current, which gives static resistance. Static resistance. We also can calculate dynamic resistance, where it is change in voltage by change in current. Dynamic means variation. So So change in voltage by change in current gives you dynamic resistance. If this you assume it as V1 and this as V2, this as I1 and this as I2, this is change in current delta I, this is change in voltage, we can say it as delta V. Delta V by delta I will give dynamic resistance. So static as well as dynamic resistance can be observed. But the thing is, you have to take that particular values after the cut-in voltage where you are having a steeper exponential graph. Similarly, when p-type is connected to a negative terminal and n-type is connected to positive terminal, we call this as reverse bias. Let us see. When this p-type is connected to a negative terminal, here negative voltage is applied, these are positive charges. So obviously there is a tendency of attraction. As they are oppositely charged, there will be a tendency of attraction of these positive charges to the negative terminal. So all the holes move towards the terminal. Similarly, electrons to the other terminal where positive terminal is connected. So holes will be moving in this direction, electrons will be moving in the other direction, resulting in the increase in the space charge region or depletion layer. This depletion layer will be increased. As you go on increase the negative voltage, this potential barrier will increase and it will be almost reaching the terminals. At this point, whatever charges are there inside, they will be freely moving, which indicates that it has reached a breakdown. It has reached a breakdown. So that particular voltage, we call it as a breakdown voltage. Okay. This phenomena, this property of a diode can be used for switching purpose. When the diode is forward bias, it can be represented with a short circuit. When it is reverse bias, it can be represented with an open circuit. So open circuit and short circuit, which can be used for switching purpose. So we call this PN junction diode as electronic switch also. This PN junction diode is also called as an electronic switch. Now let us see. Diode, on condition, off condition. In on condition, it can be represented by a short circuit. In off, it can be represented by open circuit. When it can be, you can say it is in on state, when the biasing is forward biased, and here it is reverse biased. When forward bias, you can say it is in on state, when reverse bias, you can say it is in off state. So simply, the diode can be used as a switch. Where are the applications of these diodes? A simple application, let us take a clipper. A clipper is a simple application of a diode where you use the switching property of this diode. I'll take some AC signal as input, say 10 volts peak to peak, 1 kilohertz sinusoidal signal. I'll just connect it to a diode. So practically, to limit the current, we'll be using a resistance, say 1 kilo ohm resistance is used to protect the device. Now here I will be observing the output. Now clearly, let us see the switching action of this diode with respect to the sinusoidal signal. Say this is the input signal, and here let us draw the output. Now let us divide this into three parts, 1, 2, and 3. 1 and 3 we call them as positive half cycles, 2 is a negative half cycle here. Let us see what happens when it is positive half cycle, what happens when it is negative half cycle. Remember, we are not using a practical diode so far, and we did not go for practical diodes. I am just explaining you about ideal diodes right now. Ideal diode has a cut-in voltage of 0 in general. Now, as I apply the sinusoidal signal, the positive half cycle, for this positive half cycle, the voltage is more. It implies that the anode potential is more. This is anode potential is more than cathode potential. Now, what will be the cathode potential? Usually that this is connected to ground. Ground potential is 0 volts always. So the potential at cathode is 0 volts. If the potential here is some positive value, some positive voltage, positive with respect to 0 means this is positive, this is 0 volts. Therefore, the diode will be in on state. In on state, if the diode is in on state, you can replace it with a short circuit. If I replace it with a short circuit, this is your equivalent. What will be the output? Output voltage is taken across the diode. Now, as diode is acting as a short circuit, voltage across a short circuit is 0. So, output becomes 0. Now, let us see. For entire positive half cycle, the anode potential of the diode is positive, cathode potential is 0. Therefore, for entire positive half cycle, the output will be 0. For the entire positive half cycle, the output will be 0. That means it is not allowing the positive half cycle to its output. It is just bypassing it. Now, the next part is negative half cycle. At negative half cycle, the potential here is negative. Let's take the diode once again. Let us draw it. Now, the potential here is negative, and here the voltage is 0. Clearly observe, the anode is connected to negative. It is similar to anode connected to negative, and here it is 0. Therefore, you can say this as reverse bias. When it is reverse bias, it acts as open circuit. When it acts as open circuit, there is no path for the current to flow. I through the circuit is 0. Current is 0. When the current will be 0? This is the place where most of the students commit mistakes. Current is 0 means they will say voltage is 0. It's not voltage as 0. The current is 0 means the potential difference is 0 by definition. Potential difference by resistance is current, right? The potential difference is 0. If the potential difference is 0 means both points are at same potential. Both the points are at same potential. Whatever potential is here, the same voltage is here. Here we are calling this voltage as the input voltage Vi. So here also the voltage will be Vi. Then only current becomes 0. So if you can simply read, the current through this is Vi minus V0. As I is equal to 0, this must be 0. Which implies V0 is equal to Vi. Therefore, whatever input is there, that input will be appearing across the output terminals. So, for the negative half cycle, input is sinusoidal, Vm sin omega t, output also will be Vm sin omega t. Again, positive half cycle, it is 0. Negative half cycle. Like that, the positive half cycles are eliminated, and only negative half cycles are appearing. This is a simple clipping circuit where the reference is taken as 0 volts. Instead, I can take some reference voltage Vr. The same explanation holds good, provided now the potential here at anode, the cathode, is not 0 but some positive voltage plus Vr. Now we will be comparing the input signal with respect to Vr. In earlier case, we compared it with respect to 0, but now we are comparing it with respect to Vr. That's the only difference. And let us take the case of a practical diode. For a practical diode, the cut-in voltage V gamma is equal to 0.3 for germanium and 0.7 for silicon. As we are not using germanium diodes in most of the applications, let's not go for this. We will be just using silicon 0.7. It's better to remember 0.7 volts as the cut-in voltage in general, until or unless it is not specified for germanium. Usually we use only silicon diodes here in our academic purpose or in our labs or wherever we use. Germanium diodes we are not using. Right? So cut-in voltage is 0.7. And this cut-in voltage will be acting here. Practically, the cut-in voltage of 0.7 will be acting. Whether you take a clipping application or a clamping application or a rectifier application or even in forward and reverse bias of PN junction diode, it will be the same. 0.7 will be the cut-in voltage, and that cut-in voltage will be either added or subtracted from the total output. That's the only difference. Right? This is about a clipping circuit. So one more application is rectifiers. Rectifier is a device which converts a given AC signal into a DC. Of course, it is not only a rectifier, it is a simple block diagram. It is based on this block diagram, it can convert an AC signal into a DC signal. In this rectifier is one path where it converts an AC signal into a pulsating DC. Here, we call this as AC signal, this as pulsating DC. This has unregulated DC. And finally, that is pure DC. So whatever signal we get from these mains, it is AC signal. In India, it is 230 volts, 50 hertz. If you go to US, it is 110 volts, 60 hertz. So it depends on country to country. Whatever it is, whatever AC signal we are getting from the mains, that signal is taken here as input. This is passed through a transformer. Usually transformers are either step up or step down transformers. Generally used transformer is a step down transformer, as electronics deals with low voltages, low currents and low powers. So a step down transformer is used. The output of a step down transformer will be also an AC signal, which is lesser in magnitude compared to this 230 volts. Now, this is passed through a rectifier circuit. This rectifier may be either a half wave or full wave or a bridge rectifier. Bridge rectifier is also a full wave rectifier. There are a few differences between half wave and full wave. That is a small theoretical part which you can go through. This rectifier will convert this AC signal into a pulsating DC. Means pulses, sinusoid pulses of either positive or negative amplitudes. So usually we design for positive amplitudes, because we need a positive voltage, we design for positive amplitudes. Okay, AC signal is converted into a train of sinusoidal positive pulses. This we call it as a pulsating DC. Now, we require a pure DC, so we have to pass it through a filter. We have to filter the components. A simple C filter can be used, or L filter can be used, or LC filter or RLC filter. You have choke filters. Whatever it is, basic C filter is enough. There are certain drawbacks by using an inductor in a filter. Don't touch these drawbacks. As in syllabus, you are having only capacitive filter. Let us talk about a capacitive filter. When a capacitive filter is used, the output of filter will be something like this: charging and discharging of a capacitor. Discharge time constant is large, charging time constant is small. That's how we design this part. So, you will be getting something like this, a triangular waveform, something like a sawtooth waveform. We call this as unregulated DC. This unregulated DC is passed through a voltage regulator. It may be a variable voltage regulator or a fixed voltage regulator, like IC723, or IC723 is usually a variable voltage regulator. Or you can use either LM7805, 7809, 7812, or simply we can say 78XX and 79XX series. 78XX series will give positive voltages and 79XX negative voltages. This XX indicates the voltage. 05 indicates 5 volts DC, 09 9 volts DC, 12 12 volts DC, like that. Okay, that is the basic idea of a rectifier. And you can have clamping also. Now let's go back to the diode once again with this simple block diagram. This is voltage across diode. This is applied voltage V. Because of this, a current of ID is flowing through this. This is the device, diode. This is the diode. Now I am going to connect you to the second CO, which is transistors. Human tendency is, if you are going to have more, you get more. If I offer something to you as free, you are ready to take. But if I offer the same thing to you at some price, you will think of it whether to take it or not. So always we want more. I don't want to give extra, but I want more. Everywhere this bargaining is there, and it is a general human tendency. Similarly, here let us see, apply the same thing. Here I don't want to give more voltage, I don't want to give more input, but here I want more, which gives the concept of amplification. That means I want to amplify the output without giving an extra input. Whatever is given is fixed, but I want more at the output. So how can we do it? Let us think of possible ways here. Let us say this voltage is fixed. As long as this voltage is fixed, current ID is fixed. Basically, current means rate of change of charge. Am I right? Mobility of charges. If you see a charge is moving from one point to another point, rate of change of this charge constitutes current. Or simply speaking, I is equal to dq by dt. So this is how I can define current. If this voltage is fixed and I want to improve or increase the voltage here, Vd is to be increased. Voltage across the diode is to be increased. How can a voltage be increased? V is equal to IR, simply speaking. As for a diode, let us say R is fixed or constant. V is proportional to I. Right? So I can increase V if I can increase I. Voltage can be increased only when current can be increased. How can I increase current? Current can be increased when the applied voltage is increased. Here, current can be increased when the applied voltage is increased or the charges are increased. The charges are increased. So applied voltage is constant. So we have to go for the other case, increase the number of charges. How can I increase the number of charges? Take an extra terminal, inject a few charges into it. Number of charges will increase. As number of charges increases, current automatically increases. As a result of which, I am increasing the voltage here. Did I get more? Yes. This is the concept of amplification. So for that, what is that I have taken? Another terminal which is injecting the charges. So this gives rise to a third terminal, and this became a three terminal device. And this three terminal device, we called it as a transistor or a triode. So concept of amplification. For the concept of amplification, we have gone for transistors. And there are a lot many interesting facts about these transistors. These are of two types, either PNP or NPN. Let us take a PNP transistor, simple PNP transistor. This is P-type. N-type, and this is P-type. It has three terminals. Basically, we call these three terminals as collector, base and emitter. or emitter basin collector, sorry. Both are same, but while writing, this should be emitter and that should be collector, and I'll explain you why. Emitter and this is collector. Usually, the emitter terminal doping, whatever we take here is depending on the doping concentration and size. Doping concentration and size. This is about emitter, base and collector. The doping concentration of emitter must be very high. The doping concentration must be very high. Why do we need very high doping concentration? Doping means the process or phenomena of adding impurities. If you add one impurity in say 1000 atoms, it becomes one impurity of group 3 in a 1000 atoms, it becomes p-type semiconductor, right? So if one impurity is added, you can generate one free electron. You want more number of free charges, you need to add more number of impurities. Here emitter should emit the charges. Emitter should emit the charges. So more number of charges are to be produced here. Therefore, doping concentration must be high so that more number of free charges are available to be emitted. Now coming to the size. Size of the emitter must be moderate. Size of the emitter must be moderate so that it can accommodate more number of free charges, as well as it can transfer these free charges to the other side, n-type semiconductor material. So that's what we are looking after. Doping concentration must be very high and size must be moderate. Coming to base, the base doping concentration is very low. Very low doping concentration. Size is also very small. Why doping concentration must be low? The doping concentration must be low such that whatever charges are emitted from the emitter, it has to provide a path for all these charges to reach the collector. It has to provide a path for almost all the charges to reach the collector. Should not eliminate any of the charges in between. So the doping concentration must be kept as low as possible, such that the number of recombinations here in the base region is less and more number of charges are transferred to the collector. Because of the recombinations, some current is lost here in the base region. Now collector, we are not bothered about the doping concentration or size of the collector. Usually size of the collector is large. In doping concentration, we don't bother about the doping concentration, because whatever charges are here, these charges are to be collected at the collector. Then only current is constituted. So we will take moderate. The doping concentration of the collector is moderate. And now, for these charges to move from emitter to collector, a proper biasing is required. Proper biasing is required. As we are having three terminals, proper biasing is to be applied between these three terminals. So you can have one input and one output. Input is applied at one port, which should have two terminals. Output is to be applied at one port, which has two terminals. Total you require four terminals, whereas we are having only three. Therefore, we will make one terminal common to both input and output, such that we will have two terminals or one port for input, two terminals or one port for output. So one terminal is made common. Based on that, you will have common base, common collector or common emitter. When base is made common to both input and output, input is given to emitter and base, output is taken across collector and base, it becomes common base configuration. When input is given between emitter and collector, output is taken between, sorry, base and collector, output is taken between emitter and collector. So it becomes common collector configuration. When input is between base and emitter, output is taken between base collector and emitter, it is common emitter configuration, where emitter is made common to both input and output. These are three different transistor configurations we can have. Now let us see what is the importance of biasing here. How do we bias these and why? So as we are having three different terminals, and we can either forward bias or reverse bias the junction. We have two junctions here. This junction we call it as emitter junction and this one as collector junction. Let us mark these two junctions, JE and JC. Emitter junction is forward bias, or let us say both junctions are reverse biased. What happens? When both junctions are reverse biased, then let us see. P-type is connected to negative, N-type is connected to positive. Right? This is reverse bias. When this is reverse bias, the charges will not flow to base region. All the charges, majority carriers are holes here, and these holes will tend to attract towards the terminal. The space charge width or emitter junction will be more, because of which no current is there. If no charges are transferred to the collector region, then how come current is constituted? So this is off state. This is off state. Now let us go for the next case. Emitter junction is forward bias, collector junction is a reverse bias. Let us discuss about this state after the next case. This is a reverse bias, this is forward bias. What happens in this case? Emitter junction is reverse bias like this, collector junction is forward bias. If there are no charges from emitter, no charges moving from emitter to collector, emitter to base and then to collector, then current is not there. No current flows in this direction, but as the other side is forward bias, the charges from collector tend to move towards the emitter in opposite region, in opposite direction. We call this as reverse active region or reverse active state, which we never use it. There is no use of this reverse active state for us so far. When both are forward biased, when both the junctions are forward biased, so this is a forward bias connection, P-type connected to positive, N-type negative, here also N-type negative and P-type to positive. Now current will be flowing from emitter to base as well as collector to base. Both the junctions are very small, and therefore we can call this as on state. It is almost short, on state. So when a transistor is used in these two cases, like both junctions are either forward bias or reverse bias, we can use a transistor as a switch. Now as I have told you, this particular case let us discuss later. The emitter junction is to be forward bias and collector junction is to be reverse bias. Let us discuss this case. Connecting P-type to positive, N-type to negative, here N-type to positive and P-type to negative. Now you can say emitter junction is forward bias and collector junction is reverse bias. Why do we need to reverse bias the collector junction so that the charges will transfer? For example, there are 100 holes here and say 5 electrons. Majority carriers are holes, minority carriers are electrons. As doping concentration is high, let us assume that there are 100 holes in the P-type region, emitter region. when this emitter junction is powered by us, these 100 holes tends to move into the base region. Base is of n-type. In n-type region, majority carriers are electrons and minority carriers are holes. Say there are 5 electrons and 2 holes.
There are
5 electrons and 2 holes. Now, these holes tend to move into the base region. When these holes try to enter into the base region, there are 5 oppositely charged particles. So, few holes try to recombine with these electrons. These holes try to recombine with these electrons. Even though 5 electrons are lost, 5 holes are lost in recombination, still we are having 95 holes which are coming from emitter region. Right? From emitter you are having 95 holes. Now, when this junction is powered by us, there is no use, because even though the minority carriers are holes in this, the hole concentration or minority carrier concentration in the base region is very high. Therefore, we need to reverse bias the collector junction so that all these 97 holes move into the collector region, tends to move into the collector region. Once these holes are pushed into the collector region, they are attracted to the opposite charge terminal easily. So, once it reaches the terminal, we say it is forming a closed loop because of which current is constituted. So, do remember, current will be constituted only when the emitter junction is forward biased and the collector junction is reverse biased. And this is the condition for amplification. And here it is used as amplifier. So, this is the basic concept. We can use these transistors in these 3 states. When I use it in these 2 states, that means emitter junction is forward biased and collector junction is emitter and collector junctions both are forward biased, it is on state. When both are reverse biased, it is off state. When emitter junction is forward biased and collector junction is reverse biased, it is used as amplifier. The 4th case we are not going to deal with is emitter junction reverse biased and collector junction forward bias. This is a reverse active state which we don't usually use it.
For more updates, download the KL Radio app on Play Store or visit www.klradio.com.